views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the participants and do not reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
BronxNet. Your voice, your views, your vision.
Good evening and welcome to Bronx Talk, now in its 17th year, one of New York's longest running weekly talk shows. We're not taking phone calls tonight because of the Memorial Day holiday, but as always, you can email comments to us at bronxtalk@hotmail.com, and we'll read those on the air during a future edition of our program. Well, with the digital age bursting at the seams with advancements on a daily basis, BlackBerries, iPads, iPhones, and who knows what else, there's a line of technology that's designed to assist senior citizens, the homebound and the ill. It's fascinating and useful and cutting edge, and we're going to see it firsthand tonight. So please join me in welcoming from a company that provides vital health care and safety monitoring solutions and products called CMS Telehealth. It's Willie Miska. Good evening. Thank you for joining us. And also Joseph Rabinowitz. Thank you for joining us. Mr. Miska, let's start with you. We have many things we're going to show tonight, but give me the philosophy of what you're working with and why we have all these new, gadgets, and what they're really able to do for people who really might be most in need.
What we've come up with as a company is to provide solutions that would provide 24/7 in and out of home solutions that would monitor not only vital health care and safety monitoring, but also would allow seniors as well as those who are elderly and ill to stay at home and age in place. The idea behind it is that I think everyone is familiar that the health care thing has changed over the years in terms of consumers having higher deductibles, in terms of readmissions that the government is now pushing very hard that they want to save some money. And what we essentially have now is a healthcare industry which is at about $2.3 trillion. And one of the major issues that the government wants to address is the idea of chronic disease management, which has to do with hypertension, congestive heart failure, diabetes, and asthma. And we've come up as a company to address these solutions so that institutions will have patients stay at home and at the same time provide them with prevention and healthcare services without having to go into a hospital emergency room.
Many of our Bronx senior citizen friends who are watching right now are going to look and say, oh my goodness, new technology, how am I going to deal with this? This is a very difficult thing. It's bad enough that I can't figure out my cell phone. Now you want me to have these vital things that I need put into new technology. What's your response to that?
Our response to that is that's exactly what we do. We go in, we actually do the training. We do not offer solutions that are difficult for the consumer to use. If somebody is more technologically oriented or somebody travels, we'll recommend solution A. If it's someone who stays more at home and is not comfortable with technology or needs language assistance in terms of some of the devices, we can actually program it to accommodate their languages, number one. Number two, the solutions that we offer are designed for institutions as well as for individuals who live at home with simplicity of use. So that if you come to us, we will not push a particular product. We will actually work with a solution based upon language that the population is familiar with, so that if it's English or Spanish or Chinese, we could actually design it around that. And at the same time, we make it so that anyone can use the product. And if we feel the product doesn't work, we recommend a different solution.
So I don't want to necessarily assert that it's custom-made, but it's customized for the use and the needs of a particular patient.
That is correct.
And I'm going to anticipate another question that I know all the seniors and their relatives are asking. Wait a minute, you're putting new gadgets, you're putting new gizmos here. Who's paying for all this? And is my current coverage going to deal with this, or the minute you introduce a new way of caring for people, you know what's going to happen? They're not going to cover it. I got all these great new things, but nobody can pay for it?
That's an excellent question, and that's a question, as you can imagine, we get all the time.
How did I know?
So what we have available are solutions that the consumer is familiar with, is currently paying out of pocket. And then we have a number of solutions that are provided in some cases by home health care agencies and in some cases the hospitals. There is no real reimbursement yet globally for telehealth services. It varies by state. Each person has to look in terms of what's out there. Medicare has an allowance but does not pay extra for using telehealth services. It's really an individual decision that's made by a home health agency that's certified. So in a case, for example, if you're using a personal emergency response, that is something consumers have been paying out of pocket, and in some states that is reimbursable. Again, somebody would have to check with Medicaid to see exactly what the situation is. Mm-hmm. Some of the more expensive technology, we believe the reimbursement will be coming shortly. The medication dispensers, again, these are things that prevent people from going into a nursing home in many cases because they prevent you from getting disoriented. And on the consumer side, many consumers have been paying for this, and in some states there is an allowance for it, and it's broken out on the internet.
You know, while we are going to go through a lot of these things, and they're absolutely fascinating, and the way it strikes me is these really can revolutionize the way people receive care and can simplify it and really make the care more immediate, and we're going to demonstrate that for you. One last question for you before we move on, and that is, in terms of its use, is it widespread now? Is it just beginning? And in the long term, I guess, do you anticipate that this is going to be these are going to be the trends for the future?
So to answer your question, it's really a twofold response. One is, as far as the personal emergency response type of things that people are familiar with, that is being used across the country.
And that refers to the cliche,
But we have some more extensive.
And we're going to demonstrate some of that, too. Yeah.
And we have some more extensive technology that allows you not to have to stay in your home and the flexibility of traveling anywhere you want for a few dollars more than you're currently paying out of pocket. So we'll talk about that. And the medication dispenser is something that people are familiar with. They are using it. They do pay out of pocket. Telehealth is becoming something that's becoming more popular because the hospitals will not get reimbursed in the very near future for readmissions for chronic diseases. What that means essentially to a consumer is that if you're discharged from the hospital and you get readmitted within 30 days, the hospital at some point in time will not get reimbursed for it. So they are currently looking at these solutions very, very carefully. How they will provide it, no one really knows, whether it'll be they'll offer it or the consumer will have to pay. We don't know that yet.
I guess it's time for Mr. Rabinowitz, our technical advisor, to come on in here, and for our director, Michael, we're going to be focusing on a lot of these things. I know we're going to start over here, so Mr. Rabinowitz, you have the floor. Let's play show and tell, and what are some of these things?
Sure, thank you. These devices over here are what we call remote telehealth.
Okay, so that is these right here. Okay, go ahead.
Correct. I would say these three over here are what we call remote telehealth vital signs monitoring devices.
Okay.
And really what they do is these act as a hub so that when somebody takes their blood pressure, for example, or their weight at home, that data, instead of staying with the blood pressure monitor or the weight scale, travels to these devices, and it could be with a wire or wirelessly depending on the particular device.
Right.
And from this device it gets transmitted to a server. So that data is now accessible with history and trends for an indefinite period of time.
And this would go to your doctor. So now this particular monitor then is now in your home, or this is what's on the back end, on the hub end, as it were, with the providers?
I don't know. So these are basically the miniatures. This is what would be at home. And these are, you know, they look miniature, but these are complex devices. These devices used to be a full-blown computer. And these are now miniature, and they can do the same thing. They act as the hub in the house, and they send the data out to a server where it's all collected. And once that data is there, it can then be accessed by the patient, by a caretaker, printed out to the physician.
As opposed to a process that I suppose so many people are familiar with, and that is, they just took my blood pressure, or other vital signs, or other important indicators. Did you get that information yet? I got it, but we didn't send it to the specialist. The specialist didn't get it to the surgeon. This way, much like when you're in the hospital and, they take vital signs, and, of course, it's available literally anywhere in the world, you're saying that these portable devices make this available.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And even more so, I would say that, you know, a lot of times somebody's not feeling well, so they'll go to their physician, and then the physician will take their blood pressure or their weight or their pulse, and they'll have an episodic picture of what it is at that given point in time. Whereas this gives you a continuous reading over a long period of time, which is a lot of rich and valuable data that could really be used to improve people's health.
Mr. Miska is saving trips to the doctor, in part because you can have some of these things read at home, and the doctor can get the information without you having to go in the office. Am I making that judgment?
The answer is really twofold. Yes, it can prevent you from going to the doctor, but more importantly, excuse me, if there's a problem early on, it's picked up immediately rather than waiting until you have the next doctor's appointment. So you really prevent something from getting out of control, which is a nice piece of confidence. The family members are concerned about their loved ones.
Right. And so they see a number that's of concern, you can deal with it right away, with again, without having that process.
There'll be an alert that will actually go.
Why don't you hold this and hold it up? What is this? It looks like a cell phone.
Correct, and that's exactly what it's intended to look like, because this is similar to these devices in the sense that it's a hub, but like we said at the beginning, we tailor the solutions for the consumer, and in this case, this would be appropriate for somebody who is mobile and active and goes out and wants something they could take with them, as opposed to something like this that would typically be tethered with a wire.
So it basically serves the same function, but the beauty of it is you stick it in your pocket, and then you can monitor maybe some of your vital signs in other situations if you were moving around.
Correct, and it adds a certain layer of simplicity in the sense that, again, there are no wires. It will communicate like a cell phone through the cellular network and send out all the data.
Let's trade here. Is there something different about this that's worth talking about, or are these similar concepts?
So this device is very similar. This has broad support for a lot of peripheral devices, and the advantage of this device is that it can be plugged into a home network. So you have a broadband connection right in the back over here, or a phone line, and then you don't have cellular expenses that you would have with the cellular-based technology. So they provide similar function, but there would be a different pricing.
And again, it's like what Mr. Miska said in the beginning. Maybe there is a senior citizen who has a computer or has some broadband access, or maybe has it wired but not wireless, and then you can just use this and do it that way.
Exactly.
Or again, all these things are the same thing, but for different applications and customizable for a consumer. That's where we're
going with this. And there's one other item which Joseph is going to get to now, which is even more extensive, which is interactive. And we have a number of different solutions that we offer in that regard.
Okay, so now, that's this pile again?
This device. You know, obviously, this device looks much bigger than these two. And the reason that is because this has an LCD, a screen over here. And rather than the data just going from here to here, to the server and being stored over there, there's two-way communication so that you could actually send the patient information onto the screen over here and a question series, for example, of how are you feeling today? Do you have any pains? On a scale of 1 to 10, how bad does it hurt?
And you could simply input the information.
And the patient, yeah, only four buttons. They answer appropriately based on the selection that displays on the screen, and now you have even more data to work with.
And again, this is transmitted instantaneously, and responses can be given.
In real time.
Wow.
In real time.
All right, now this, we're going here now, right?
Yeah, these are the...
This looks like a bathroom scan, folks.
Exactly.
what is this?
This is...
A bathroom scan.
This is exactly that. It's a bathroom scale, except for it is a lot more high-tech in the sense that once you get onto this device, instead of the reading just being here through your eyes, and a lot of people also have an issue that they can't see the scale, small numbers, et cetera, the data will actually get transmitted from here to one of these hubs and stored there.
And then transmitted in the same way.
Exactly.
So this is a scale of somebody who weight is an issue for many people. Your weight's too high. They can match up now your blood pressure with your weight and have all that information. And Mr. Miska, is the healthcare industry and healthcare providers ready for this? I can see doctors saying, you know what, I'm getting all this information, I don't have the time to look at it. Or are they welcoming it because they say, you know what, for the first time I can analyze or at least get some of the basics of a patient without having to, you know, go any further than I have to.
We think that right now they're concentrating predominantly on the latest technology, which is the electronic medical record. But we think that in the next year or two they will be ready for it, although at this point in time there is a lot of data that will come in. And, you know, we feel that at the moment it's not being used by the physician population. It's more on the institutional as well as individuals who want to use it for themselves, for their own personal data, no matter what's going on.
it sounds to me like, based on what you've told me in the past and what we're looking at tonight, it sounds like this is the a wave, one of the waves of the future.
The answer is yes, and the scale, just to go back to that, right. The importance of the accuracy of that scale is critical when you're dealing with someone who has heart failure. So we will not recommend a scale that is not, you know, checked out by us that, number one, it works the way it should, and number two, the accuracy is critical, because if you're off by one or two, it makes a major difference with a heart failure.
All right, let's see. So now what is this? Why don't you show us what this is?
This is, you know, what you would typically see at the doctor's office when you get your
blood pressure.
Your blood pressure. There's a cuff and a simple device here. You just press start after you wrap it on your arm. And similar to the scale, once the reading is here, it gets transmitted to these devices. And this would also be recommended for somebody who has hypertension and needs to monitor that on a regular basis.
People would do this on their own?
Yes.
In
most cases, people do it on their own. In some cases, if somebody doesn't have the capacity to, then when a nurse or a visiting attendant comes in, they would assist them with it.
They would do it, but then again, the nurse doesn't have to write it down.
Correct.
Let's keep going. Keep trading. What do we got here?
Sure. This is a glucometer. So obviously, anybody that's diabetic would want to be monitoring their blood sugar level on a regular basis.
And they can do it, and clearly it's portable.
It's extremely portable, extremely lightweight. And again, the data will go straight from here to one of these devices and stored.
And what is this?
This is a
pulse
oximeter.
Say that again?
Pulse oximeter, so somebody needs to monitor their pulse, blood oxygen levels.
People with heart conditions.
Correct. So this provides a lot of rich data that would be stored along with any other monitors that they have.
What can go wrong? You lose a battery, somebody relies on these things. I mean, you say, gee whiz, now it didn't work, and all of a sudden, something didn't go wrong. I'm assuming you build in for those kinds of contingencies.
Sure. So the nice thing is a lot of the technologies allow us today to actually monitor things like battery levels from the server side. So we would actually be able to send an alert when there is a low battery. But on the flip side of that is if a battery were to die or something was not functioning properly.
Internet dies or power failures, I mean, we know what...
Right, so this is not something where we're dealing with emergencies or life or death situations in most cases. This is just a continuous stream of data. So if it were down for a day or two, right, we would recommend that they be checked out by somebody.
In the old-fashioned way.
Right, but it's not like an ER where something goes down, you hear an alarm, and boom, somebody's got to get there instantly.
Mr. Miska, I believe we had covered this on the previous show during when the... I think it was the Obama administration insisted on, and you already referred to it, on computerizing personal data and medical data in the doctor's office. And frankly, my physician, if he's watching tonight, looked at me the first couple of times and said, "I can't deal with this. This is non-personal. It's not helping me get care." Is there a sense or a concern from some people that this may be a little less personal? That maybe the visit from a nurse or somebody would be more valuable than, frankly, just carrying one of these rooms?
The answer to that question is maybe not for the physician, but when a patient is discharged, it's critical that they be followed, and they be followed very, very actively. What this allows you to do is, more importantly than on the physician side, is that when the patient is discharged, the doctor knows that this patient is being monitored regularly, and rather than before something gets out of control, there's an alert that will come to our monitoring station, we will notify somebody, so it's not that the patient has to wait 2 weeks to go to them. Ultimately, the patient will have to go back to a physician if something is not working properly. As Joseph mentioned, we will pick up those alerts, because if somebody doesn't check in, we monitor that. Mm-hmm. And that's something that's critical.
We are going to also, what I haven't shown, people who watch our show know we have a different background, and that's another piece of technology. I want to move a little more quickly because we have so much more to show. What is this? This you said was in use already, right? This is a medicine dispenser of some sort?
Yes, that's a medication dispenser. And as you know, a lot of people, especially aging or people with chronic disease, have to take a lot of medication and manage those, which gets complicated. A lot of people have those pill boxes for 1 week.
Sure.
This gives you an average of 30 days you can fill in. You could have a caretaker or yourself put it in inside, and the device will automatically, based on a preset timer, show up and
be... I'm going to mess it up. Why don't you try to open it up quickly and just demonstrate what... Can you do that? Oh, sure. There you go.
The device has a tray.
I think let's just keep it together and hold the whole thing together so you can see it. Okay.
Sure.
And now what are we seeing, and what is the technology side of it? Obviously, there are many different medications.
Right, so the technology side of it is that you have a clock here that's similar to an alarm clock, and you set the medication pattern for how...
Or in coordination with a physician or some caregiver.
Correct, or even some pharmacy to work with it directly, pre-filling the prescriptions, and that way you only get the correct prescription at the set time.
All right, let's move quick because I want to really get a chance to show what's behind us. So now what is this? These are similar kinds of things.
Correct. This is a different...
Let's be real quick.
This is a different type of technology. There's a major issue these days with aging in place versus going to a nursing home, which obviously is very expensive, large cost and burden to everybody. This helps with that, and it does so unobtrusively because these are sensors. Most people are familiar with this, which is what a motion sensor looks like. Mm-hmm. And this over here is actually a bed sensor. Both sense movement and action. This senses pressure. That senses motion.
And then that goes to the hub and then gets translated to a caregiver who is monitoring the various processes.
Correct. So even something like this is particularly important when it comes to, let's say, somebody that sleeps at night. They will usually, on average, you could see over the course of months, wake up once or twice. Right. Somebody waking up three or four times could be a UTI, urinary tract infection. That's a lot.
And somebody may not even know they have an issue, but somebody monitoring this would say, you know what, this is something we ought to come in with.
All right,
this is this classic, I've fallen and I can't get up. Explain what this is, and then I want to make sure we have time to go to the board behind.
Sure. So this over here is the classic, I've fallen and I can't get up, and this is still a great technology for a lot of people who are in-home. Basically, you have the transmitter over here and a pendant. You press the button. If there's an emergency, you can communicate, and they could send emergency personnel.
Right.
This over here is a modern version of this. It allows you the same protection, but you could be mobile with it. You could take this out with you. You could walk.
So if you fall and can't get up, but you can't do that with this.
No, this requires that you be in proximity to this, which is typically within the house. This you could take literally anywhere in the country, and as long as there's cellular coverage, it will transmit a signal and an alert for help call to caretakers, to emergency service.
It can be plugged into whomever you think needs to have it.
Correct.
Even a friend or a relative who
might live. Exactly. So some people don't want to alert the emergency authorities right away. They would rather call a friend or a family member, and you could certainly do that.
And it happens automatically. You have this crisis, and then and an alert is sent and whatever.
Correct. You have a crisis. You're able to press the middle button, which is an SOS call, or other buttons to call other people.
All right, the big daddy of them all. What is this behind us? And I think this is fascinating. We have a couple of minutes, and I want to show what this is.
Sure. This is an exciting new technology. It's really one of the newest healthcare delivery platforms out there. And that is, there's a major issue, which is, people are very busy. They want to go out there. There's a shortage of primary care physicians. This allows you to get the healthcare that you want, where you want it, and when you want it.
Basically, you can talk to your doctor or other caregiver one-on-one.
Correct. And the idea is not to replace your primary care physician. We're firm believers in that sometimes you need somebody to touch you and feel you. But in many cases, it's late night, you fall and you see something you don't like, a discharge. You don't want to run to the emergency room or clinic.
Is this any more? Well, let's play it, and then I'm going to ask my question. So let's see what this looks like, okay? Who does that? Do we do that here, or they do it upstairs?
Let's do it right here.
Let's do it.
So what we have is
a
patient would sign into their account. And let's say they want to see a doctor, and we have a pre-recorded sample over here. They were able to go in and select the doctor that they want to see, and that could be based on somebody that they've already seen.
If the doctor called, I've got a chest cold or a head cold, it's now in my chest, I'm coughing, and it's productive.
And what does it look like?
It's actually yellow.
Dark yellow. Green.
It's dark yellow.
It's dark yellow. Yeah. Is that fever?
But I have a pretty bad headache frequently.
Okay. Are you having any problems with your stomach?
No, not
vomiting?
No, I'm not.
Okay. And do you feel like your sinuses are congested?
No, I didn't hear what you just said.
Well, what I'd like you to do, John, is take your finger, your right index finger, and poke it over your... Does that hurt?
Yes, it does. That's bad.
How about the other side?
I can feel it. It makes my teeth hurt, too.
What this is now, Is it any, this was the question I was going to ask when the concept was introduced. Is this any more or less sophisticated than a Skype phone call?
Sure. Yes. Yes. There are a lot of issues with a simple Skype phone call, mainly HIPAA, security, who could access that data. This is fully HIPAA compliant. It maintains a very strong layer of encryption, so nobody could get at that data.
Does it have to be activated when a doctor is ready to be there? In other words, one would think you'd need to have your doctor on call, and that we all know how difficult that can be.
So what this allows you to do is basically sign in at any point, at any time, and see any of the available physicians. So it doesn't have to be your particular doctor. You can see any of the available
physicians. Somebody on call.
Anybody that's on call.
And I have to tell you, especially for parents with young children, and if you've been a young parent and you're panicked about your baby's health, this could be used. And when you say the information's encrypted, it's not only a Skype phone call, which is, of course, like any phone call in the air, but this is all documented as you go along.
Correct. And this provides the platform so you could select that physician, whereas in Skype, you can't.
Mr. Miska, how in use is this, or is this the wave of the future?
This is in use currently. It's not as popular as we want it to be yet, but it's becoming more popular. Organizations, for example, are having their employees utilize this service because they save a significant amount of money instead of going to the physician.
Plus, they can access their physician.
And it's 24/7.
Well, they can access it. There's always somebody on call.
Always. There's always
a doctor's ready to do it.
There's always a doctor available through here, and they're certified through the neighbors that they're.
If somebody has seen these items on our show and they are caregivers or they're potential patients themselves, what do they need to do to find out more and contact you or contact providers to learn more about it and maybe even use it in their own homes? What do they do?
They can feel free to call us for a free consult, and we'll speak to them. We'll set up an appointment.
What number is that?
The number is 212-913-9897.
Okay.
And then, of course, there's a lot of information on the website.
On the website is also interesting, and that we may not have seniors who are able to use the web, so they can call. Or you go to, it's cmstelehealth.com.
That's correct.
cmstelehealth.com. Gentlemen, way more things to show than there's ever time for. But this is fascinating, and to me, it's always about opening up people's minds to what's available and the way the future is going. And, of course, the bottom line is helping people be healthier. Joseph Rabinowitz, thank you.
Thank you.
Willie Miska, thank you.
Thank you.
And, folks, if you have further comments or questions on anything you heard on tonight's show or anything going on in the Bronx, then email them to us at bronxtalk@hotmail.com. And we'll read those on the air during a future edition of our program. Archives of our program are available at bronxnet.org. You click Bronx Talk right on the right-hand navigation bar. We will see you next Monday night at 9 here on BronxNet, Cablevision 67, Verizon Fires 33. Special thanks to producer Jane Floro, director Michael Arias, and the many, many people that helped us get the technology together, and you folks, and make sure we have the Internet connection because that wasn't a small deal. And to you. We'll be right back.